Good morning to one and all. We are fortunate to have with us today one of the most experienced personality, Mr. Anish Philip, at our 15th National Business Convention. Mr. Anish Philip is presently working as an AVP-People Function at Mindtree Limited, and along with it, he is a secretary at NHRD Bangalore. Sir was also a member of senior leadership team in Mindtree and has worked in setting up business, sales, talent and customer acquisition process. Sir was one of the initiators in setting up HR practices globally and helped the company grow to US$500 million and was recognized as one of the best employees by introducing his best-in-class people practices. Sir has also worked as the head of human resources at Saskin Technologies Limited and as a consultant in E&Y serving clients in the area of HR advisory services. Sir has completed his management studies from SIBM, SIMS Pune in the year 1999, and we are extremely honored to have you at our campus. Sir, I welcome you on behalf of Balaji Institute of Modern Management to enlighten us on the topic Emerging Changes in Business Environment.
Good morning, everybody.
Good morning, sir.
Louder. Good morning.
Good morning, sir.
Yeah, so that was Balaji's slide, that used to be. My first slide, obviously, I should be telling you something about Mindtree, and, you know, I really don't want to follow any presentation formats and things like that. What I would like to do is, in the next 20 minutes, I would just like to run through something, and while I'm actually standing, a lot of things will come out which might not be there in the presentation. I would like to, you know, keep it free flowing. I would like to encourage you to ask me more questions, right? And I could share my experience of how things have gone over the last, you know, so many years for me, and what is my own learning. Be it, it's not just about HR, it is about marketing, it is about, today, and a professional is really supposed to be, you know, multifaceted. It's a multi-skilled individual that organizations look for. So I will get onto that. So Mindtree, you know, as I said, started in 99. It was a group of 10 promoters coming together and trying to, you know, set up this great company which was into the consulting. So we wanted to be very unique, rather than getting into, you know, and do some value-added services. So that was a consulting charter that the company was looking at. So today, from 99 onwards, we are looking at, we just closed the last financial year. Obviously, we're a public company. I cannot be, telling you about numbers which we have in store for this year. But you can obviously gauge that. So 780 million is what we really closed at. We are close to 17,000 employees as we stand, because we had a couple of acquisitions which we just recently merged. This is the first year, last year, that we actually grew at a 9.5% I should say, year on year. But otherwise, the company's compound annual growth rate was in the range of 15 to 16%. So we are today considered as the best in the mid-tier segment. Obviously, you have the large companies, you know, the Infosys, Wipro, and all these guys. So customers look at us more for the value. More for the people centricity, our culture, and obviously a challenger to any of the larger companies. And that's how really our positioning is. Our larger presence when it comes to business is the US market. We do 65 to 70%, that numbers keeps wavering, of our business actually comes in from the US. APAC is really about Australia, Middle East. You see that India market we have really not been focusing too much because there's so much market outside. And one pride moment for us has been really working on the Aadhaar project. So today Aadhaar is very, very important. And Mindtree takes pride in really creating the technology platform to really, and that was one of the most complex projects actually, you know, we have done. The top 7-8 is something where we always go in between that, that is in terms of the market cap amongst IT companies. And today we are obviously globally present. If you look at it, we operate in 17 to 20 countries. Just in the US itself, we operate out of 30 different states in the US. So we have an office here in Pune itself, so I keep visiting the Pune office at least once in two months. I keep coming here. We operate in four verticals, and that's really our focus area. Domain expertise, other than technology, domain expertise is something which is very important, and hence we decided that we'll operate in four areas. The first one, the larger one for us, is basically the banking and financial services, what we call as BFSI. And again here, our niche segment is really around insurance, right? For most companies, it is at 40% of their overall revenue is on the BFSI side. For Mindtree, again, what we are really looking at is insurance, and within insurance, it's property and casualty that we look at. The second one is around retail, CPG, and manufacturing. So we really try to build our expertise in the retail and the CPG side of it. The third one is around travel, hospitality, and transportation. We focus on the airlines part of it. So out of the 9 to 10 big airlines worldwide, we would be actually working with almost 70% of them. Technology media, we work with the technology companies, the likes of Microsoft, the likes of Google, Apple, or anybody, and try to help them, develop their own product strategy, their own IT strategy out there. The next row is really basically talking about the services that we offer or the technologies that we offer. And, digital is a big thing for us. Today, all companies have to really transform into the digital, otherwise their own existence will be in question mark. So 40% of our business really comes in from digital. And digital we really define, from a social media analytics, that's really basically what we try to do there. A few of our customers, our largest customer, is obviously out of the 780-800 million that I'm talking about, our largest customer happens to be Microsoft. We do more than 100 million worth of business with them. But these are a few of the customers. Now, if you look at it, we don't try to enter into areas where, which is outside our domain area. So if you get an energy and things like that, we would really not want to do that. But at the same time, we have both P&G and Unilever happen to be customers. We'll have at one point of time both Pepsi and Coca-Cola used to be customers, right? So even though rivalries between companies will be there, but companies will come to partners who will actually bring in that domain, that value to them. So on that note, I thought. The challenges, since I represent an IT company, obviously as speakers come in from different industries, they will bring out their perspective on that. So today we see a lot of doomsday statement, what is happening with IT. We see that, every day as we take up the newspaper, it's about people losing jobs, automation, are there sufficient jobs getting created? What IT used to be, the job creator for so many years, today that question mark is obviously there. Similarly, on the HR front, for the folks out here who are studying HR and trying to look at a career in HR, HR has also been coming into a lot of question mark. There's Vineet Nair, the ex-chairman of CEO and of HCL, actually saying HR will be dead by 2020. Right? So those are the set of questions that are really coming up, and obviously I would want to address that also, because when students are here and when you're actually hearing to this set of questions, I think it's important to address that rather than becoming negative about it or wondering what needs to be done. I think there's so many opportunities that lies in front of us. It's really an opportunity for people to innovate, for companies to innovate, for coming out of our comfort zone, the way we are thinking. It also puts pressure on academia, right? Institutions will also start thinking of, in what way do I groom students to be really effective? So I think there's a pressure on the entire community as such to be really looking at how do we become much more effective. At the same time, look at the demographics. Demographics is completely in favor of us, right? And if we look, read journals around World Economic Forum and things like that, on one side, we see that the population is aging in the other parts of the world. It's really India that has the demographic advantage. There are protectionism measures which are coming in from other countries and things like that. But at the end of the day, I think those are all challenges which we will overcome. We have always overcome such challenges. Now, when I joined in 99, I told you, and why I'm setting this context is basically, and the reason why I had to even narrate that. When 99 I joined again, that was the era of startups. Immediately, you know, post that, there was a whole dot-com bust that happened. 2000-2001 was a dot-com bust that happened. And again, companies struggled to really look at what needs to be done. People lost jobs and things like that. But what happened? You know, at the end of the day, people really came out strong. India came out strong, I should say. And, you know, again, the boom period started for us. 2001 to 2003, it was a really tough period for the market. We looked at, you know, the SARS issue coming up in Asia. So multiple of those things really coming up, but at the end of the day, things started again moving. 2007 was again an era like that, where companies started consolidating, growth became a thing. But I think, you know, we have come out strong, especially when I look at Indian IT industry that I represent, it has really come out very, very strong to really look at it. Now, what are really the three things, you know, which according to me is the problem? When I said IT industry has been growing at that 15-20% compounded annual growth rate, today we are looking at, you know, the industry rate growth rate actually coming down to single digit. If you look at Infosys or any of those larger companies, the large four or five companies, it has really come down to single digit. The next set of companies have also come down to the teens. I would say the growth rate has been in the teens. So gone are the days perhaps we were looking at you know, the whole thing around you know, on a higher double digit growth. The next thing is around legacy spends are declining. So today, organizations, so when we look at things, we look at, in the IT industry, we actually say run the business and change the business, right? So the run the business is our normal day-to-day running of operations, running of applications, and this has absolutely come down. And in the IT industry, we look at three things. There is a Horizon 1, Horizon 2, and Horizon 3 technologies. Now, Horizon 1 is really about how do we run our day-to-day operations. Now, this clearly used to be in the 15-20% growth rate. Today, it will actually come to that 5-7% growth rate. Companies are going to consolidate on that. Companies are actually not going to, you know, spend more money on that. There's a lot of pricing pressure that we're seeing, hence the margin squeeze. And this slower industry growth rate is obviously, how does it impact us? When the industry growth rate is slow, what will happen is, it also affects individuals in some way. It affects careers in the, you know. So IT companies have also been looking at faster promotions, faster growth for individuals. You had a lot of youngsters actually, you know, coming up and saying that, you know, in the sub 40 category, I've done this and stuff like that. I think that is really going to change because, and with that, you know, individuals, the bright individuals within the company are also going to figure out what's in store for me. I'm actually slowing down. I think I'm going through that phase right now as an HR professional where I have these discussions on a daily basis with people, with the high performers. You know, people come in and ask me, Anish, have I slowed down? You know, what is it? Now, it's not a question of that. It's a question of, how are we trying to figure out in the next couple of years, how do we get back to that growth rate? How do we give careers to people? Right? So that's basically what the problem is happening. Now, Horizon 2 is really about the new skills, which are in its own infancy to a mature stage. And here I would say digital skills. Now, this is the area which will continue to give that 15-20 or higher percentage of growth rate. And hence I said, it's important for companies to really transition from a Horizon 1 to a Horizon 2 sort of thing. And Horizon 3 is really about what are the new age technologies which are there. Now, this could be around automation, this could be around robotics, this could be around blockchain, or any of those things that we are really, really talking about. And companies need to really be focused on their strategy about Horizon 2 and Horizon 3. How are they actually going to help people in developing skills in the Horizon 2 and Horizon 3? And that is really what will define the future of the IT industry. So hence, you read a lot of things around saying that there is a lot of reskilling going on. Companies are making that statement. Companies making those investments. It's really about investing into the horizon 2, horizon 3. Though digital, there's a good amount of growth. The companies like Accenture, any of the larger companies like Infosys, Wipro and all, or Mindtree, any of these companies are in. But still the percentage, it's growing, but still the proportion is pretty, or the growth rate is pretty, pretty small, because customers are also figuring it out what they need to do from a digital strategy point of view. Second is, a lot of companies themselves are struggling. Like one of our larger customers is AIG, and AIG used to be one of our large customers. Look at what happened with AIG. It went into bankruptcy, the government had to bail them out. Today also, they are still struggling to, look at growth. But in the whole process, what has really happened, it's the technology companies. In whatever way, the technology companies have actually come out stronger, the technology companies. So technology disruption has been more. If you look at the market cap of the top 5 companies, you will see a significant change over the last 30, 40 years. Where you had no IT company, today the top 5 is actually occupied by the likes of, Google, Apple, Microsoft, Amazon, and all those things. So technology is actually completely changing the landscape. It is really growing at an exponential growth rate, which nobody really perhaps even anticipated that. The world is changing, and why is the world changing? And here I'm putting across 3 things. Technology changes, the geopolitics around going around globally, and economic volatility. And technology changes, if you look at it, what is the specialty of Uber? Anybody? Pardon?
They don't have any asset.
They are into cars. They don't have cars, absolutely. But look at it, it's the number one, company when you look at it, but they don't own a single car. What's the specialty of Airbnb?
They don't own any hotels.
Exactly. So you guys know that. And that's the reality of that. Today, companies are, not owning things what, the industry that they are into. It's technology that is driving them. And that's the reality of business. Look at what Amazon is doing. Look at what a Flipkart is doing. Right? But still, is there room for the brick and mortar companies? The answer to that is absolutely yes. Right? But if companies don't adopt technology in a big way, if companies, institutions, individuals, I think don't adopt technology in a big way, that's going to be really a problem for all. And all the new things which are really going on around artificial intelligence, IoT or anything, if you look at it, it's again a technology drive that is happening, that is, that companies are trying to adopt and get going with things. So data is the big thing, and today, data comes, this variety of this, the volume of data, today the volume of data actually doubles in every 18 months, the volume of data comes in. And that's where opportunities for big data, things like that actually comes in. The variety of data, or the velocity of data, so the 3 V's, the volume, variety, velocity, has significantly improved in the last, 18 to 24 months, I would say, and that's how technology, with that technology advancement is also happening, and that's where we are able to synthesize that particular data. I think the changing geopolitics, forget about the world, what is happening, Brexit and things like that. Now, simple, I'll tell you how things get affected. We acquired this company in the in UK, Bluefin. This was a specialist on, this is a company which really specializes on SAP HANA, one of the platinum partners for SAP. Now, immediately after our acquisition, Brexit happened. And we actually went down in a big way with that. Because companies started spending, stopped spending, they delayed their decision. And that was really why you see a 9.4%, because the acquired entities really didn't grow to anticipated, to our expectations because of geopolitical changes. Can you stop, growing business because of that? The answer is no. You need to take bets, you need to move on. So that's really about it. Let's take about geopolitical changes that happens out here. The biggest change that happened was when Trump came in. There's a whole fear about what is going to happen with immigration. protectionism. So that really became the second aspect to things. But you know, has anything happened to the IT companies? IT companies still continue to run with it. We still continue to do business. And that's really what has changed. But we changed the way we've been working. IT companies started looking at different ways of working. Can we have more development centers in the US? Can we start hiring people globally? You know, can we start hiring people in the respective locations? So diversity became the whole thing, rather than, you know, looking at hiring people out here, training them, transferring people. So IT companies are also in that change mode, the change process out there. The, if you look at India itself, there is a Make in India, you know, campaign which is there. There is, you know, the current government is trying to do a lot of things around that. There's a lot of changes on the different labor laws that is happening, and especially important for everybody, especially on the HR field. I'll tell you guys, you know, the common thought process that everybody has is that, you know, once you are out of the institute, you need not follow labor laws, unless and otherwise you are a manufacturing setup and things like that. If an IT or a services, you know, labor laws is not there. I'll tell you, please brush up on your labor laws. Your advantage tomorrow is going to be if you have thorough understanding of on labor laws. Right, the days of IR is back in the IT industry, in the service sector. Right, IT companies really ignored a lot of laws, of this labor laws and things like that, because this was an industry that was giving growth. If I look at Karnataka, does anybody know standing orders? Have you heard about it? Right, so standing orders is followed across in all states except Karnataka. Karnataka was able to get an exemption on standing orders. Why? Because we were the job creators, right? IT companies have been job creators, and the government actually said, okay, I will exempt you guys from that till the time you guys continue to create jobs, you guys continue to create continue to pay taxes, continue to, you know, so that was really the thing. Today, let me tell you, things are all coming back into, status quo. Things are coming back, the whole circle. We are again going to follow labor laws and things like that. It is going to hit IT companies in a big way. Industrial Disputes Act. Yes, sir. Right? Everybody knows that?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So there is something on layoffs, retrenchment, closure. Yes, chapter sir. What? Yes. Yeah, so anyways. So those are things which we are very, very, it's important. IT companies, you know, obviously all these things are not there. Today, with the changes in the law that is coming in, you know, I'll tell you, Industrial Disputes Act exists. But nobody has been following that. Today we are actually going through changes in laws. Okay, the different laws that has been there, that itself is changing. In the next 1 year, you will see changes happening. Right? There's a wage code which has been there that's already tabled in parliament. Right? It can actually get approved at any moment. So four of the, you know, different laws that govern wages are actually going to be enacted pretty soon with a single wage code. Similarly, there is an IR code, industrial relations wage code is there, there's a social security wage code is there. So, you know, it's important to really brush up, really go deeper into that, and and that could be your real advantage when you actually sit for placements. Right? So that's really the changes which are happening across industries. Now, did anybody go through, you know, obviously everybody, I'm sure, is on WhatsApp. Did you get a clipping of what happened at Tech Mahindra?
Yes, sir.
Okay, there's somebody, there's a HR executive who fired the individual and it became so violent, right? Now, today, that is the reality of it. Earlier, nobody in the IT industry would really talk about, you know, a layoff, or if I'm asking somebody to go, the individual will go and get another offer from a different company for at least 10% or 20% more than the existing salary. Today, realities are very, very different, right? And that's where IT employees are today looking at joining unions. It was not that they couldn't join unions before. Anybody could have joined a union. Any seven people could have, you know, stood together to form a union. But it was not required for IT professionals, IT engineers, because that was a level of opportunity. And today, they are ready to form unions, the people are coming together, there are organizations calling forward for that, and people are going and wanting to do that. Right, so that's how the reality is changing. That's how the geopolitics nature is changing. Be it immigration, be it protectionism, be it local employment, things like that. Significant changes globally that is happening. And it is not just about India, US and things like that. It is also about Singapore. You look at any country, Europe, it's the same thing across. Now, economic, the economy being volatile. And I think for us, the IT companies, especially the guys who are into export-oriented revenues, the rupee fluctuation, the dollar fluctuation actually plays a key role. You know, today you look at it, what we started the year, the financial year, we would have started at something like 67, 68 is what we are looking at 63, right? There are multiple economists actually saying we will actually go down to a 60 level. What does it mean? It means that, again, we need to reinvent. It really affects our own profitability, our own margin. So there's a whole lot of, churn that goes in. Today, my entire focus actually within the company really goes into margin improvement. So let me tell you guys, it is not just about finance or anybody looking at it. HR plays a very crucial role in looking at how margin improvement happens. And that's the reality of the world. So that is where the multi-talented, multi-skilled professional actually comes into play. So this is about, how technology, I'm just not going to repeat this particular thing, but it's about all about digital, and what we are really trying to do. Now, key market transition. So, as I said, every company is seeing itself as a technology company. Today, the brick and mortar companies that have been there, they are looking at technology. If you look at companies that have been into mining, they have completely transformed, it is becoming technology companies. If you look at oil companies, now I had this opportunity to go to, Oil India, everybody, Indian Oil, and I was amazed at their, how the technical capability that they have, what they do. There's not even one single person who was manning those pipelines and that, pipelines. It's all about sensors, it's all about IoT, and the room that they monitor is a complete cockpit of advanced technology monitoring each and everything. And that is how public sector companies have changed. Now it was really a mind, an eye-opener for me, what companies and how, even government organizations have really invested themselves in technology. So today technology is absolutely, absolutely important, be it companies, be it institutions, be it schools, anything. I think that's becoming the reality of that. The pace of change, the low teen growth, and with that, winning market share is actually very, very important. How do we do that? It can be with values, with, what is the value we create? So today, if you operate in just four verticals, the reason is that we want to be industry leaders. We want to be in the top one or two. And as somebody said, there is no price of being second, right? So if we have to really operate going forward, we have to see ourselves that how can be that in the top one or two when it comes to real domain experience, when it comes to providing value to customers. And disruption is all across. Today, the only thing which is certain is disruption will happen. There's somebody who will come with a cheaper option, will come with a faster option, and that's where the whole thing around being agile and all those things comes in. Today, the pace at which we were operating, if it was X, today we have to start operating at 5X, 10X. And that's what at least my CEO always tells, I need to create an agile organization. Okay, decisions cannot be really put across for more than 24 hours sort of thing. Okay, and that's really the speed that we are looking at. And decision making today, it is no longer, with one individual. It is at multiple levels of CXO that is actually taking decision making. So business has also become all the more complex and things like that. So what is our own view, of the future of the IT industry? And we are saying the first one is not a winner. There's not going to be one single winner. There are going to be multiple winners. Companies need to coexist. Okay, otherwise it's not going to be a reality. So today we are not, if an example if I were to take, we do not exist in business process outsourcing, the call centers and things like that. But whenever we have an opportunity to partner with companies, we try to give them, and that's really the partnership. So similarly, that partnership, what happens when they don't have anything on the application maintenance, development side and all, they try to partner with us. So that's similarly, companies like Microsoft, Oracle, SAP, you know, look at the partnerships that they are actually trying to build in. And they are aware of that. They need to coexist with the providers, with the partner, with the service providers to really win that market share. The second thing is clients will be driven by expertise and relationships. I think expertise is becoming a big, big thing. And that's where I said in each of the domains, one needs to be, like how Mindtree has done in each of the domains. When I said insurance, we are specifically looking at property and casualty. That's really our expertise, or, you know, that's a niche that we are. We could go into life, we could go into, you know, multiple things. But when it comes to property and casualty, everybody should be looking at us. When we make investments, okay, in terms of acquisition or anything, it should be in that core area. What is that expertise that you are really looking at it? So somebody at, you know, obviously you've heard the theory around core competence. I think the theory of core competence is again back. You need to really do that something. Even for individuals, I would say, please have an area of expertise for yourself as you, tomorrow when you step out of the institute, two organizations, you need to really build a career around expertise. So earlier, today the talk, you know, sometime back, the talk used to be a T-shaped individual. You understand a T-shaped individual? Now, the T is basically the breadth, right? This one, the horizontal one is the breadth, and the vertical one is one domain area. So just taking an example, if I am a HR professional, I need to have an understanding of what? Policies, labor laws, I need to have an understanding of compensation benefits, performance management, talent management, everything, talent acquisition, whatever comes into that. And but I need to have something which is much deeper. This could be, you know, compensation benefits, this could be leadership development, OD, organization development, anything. Now today, people have actually started talking about a pie-shaped individual. You understood what I said, a pie-shaped individual? So it's two, you know, you're getting into two deeperness. And let me tell you, the future will be about comb-shaped individuals. I repeat, it is C-O-M-B. Comb-shaped individuals, where you need to have thorough understanding of multiple facets. And it's not just about one knowledge, you know, just HR or something. It is about marketing, it is about finance, it is about legal compliance, everything. That's going to be a comb-shaped individual that is the expectation of the future. Size alone will not be the differentiator. So it's not about, you know, how large you are. There could be smaller companies which would actually provide us niche segmentation. So the whole thing is around expertise. What is that niche work that one is doing? And that's again a number. Today we have so many companies out there, you know, in the IT companies. I think that consolidation is going to happen. We're going to see at least less than 10 players who would actually, you know, exist. Most other folks will actually try to coexist, will try to merge. And that's the reality of it. Organizations are becoming flatter and flatter. And that's a big mindset in India also that is happening, that hierarchies are going away. We have been, you know, what was the expectation? Every 2 years I should be getting promoted. Every 2 to 3 years I should be moving out of organizations. And that's only when I see growth and things like that. I think the reality is becoming completely different. It's becoming more flat, lean, mean organization. And that helps in collaboration, that helps in, you know, improving efficiency, that is helping in improving productivity. So organizations are really looking at it. Being agile, I already made the statement. Decision making is going to be obviously much, much more complex. Right? It's not going to be easy, because at the end of the day, when I look at it, you know, I have to think at things from, you know, how is it affecting me from a legal angle? How is it affecting me from a branding perspective? How is it affecting in 10 different ways? And today, you know, as a professional, things have become very, very difficult for me. So, you know, yesterday when I was being picked up from the airport, you know, again it went on, you know, in the while we were riding back, I was on calls. You know, my calls went on till 3 a.m. in the morning. And that's the reality of business. Because for me, every day life starts at, you know, early in the morning when U.S. is ending, U.S. day is coming to a close. My day ends with, again, US beginning the day, right? And then globally, I need to cover that. With that decision-making, you know, a lot of synthesizing has to happen. How are things? So I cannot just depend on myself to be really doing that. It is multiple people who are actually involved, multiple stakeholders who are actually getting involved in the whole thing. And that's really, you know, the reality of the day. So what's the reality? If the reality is that it's not business as usual for us. Balasar was asking me what is, you know, what is happening in the IT industry. I said, the good period is over. We are still trying to reinvent. The next two cycles, the next 2 years is going to be real challenging years for the IT industry. Hence, it is not business as usual. Each of us have to reinvent. We are trying to figure out what needs to be done. With that, what really comes is about, you know, you've been hearing a lot about reskilling of talent, and that's really what companies are doing. Today, the biggest investment that Mindtree has done in 2015, we spent actually $20 million to set up a global learning facility in Bhubaneswar. And today, what we do is, all our campus minds, we get them to Bhubaneswar, they go through a 3 months of training. Was it happening before? The answer is absolutely happening before. But today the difference is we get everybody from even the US guys, campus guys that we hire, they come here, right? They spend the 3 months. But what has really changed is the methodology of learning. It is no longer classroom-led instruction and things like that. I think that's the biggest change that people are looking for, right? Today we look at more of problem-solving skills, more of hackathons that really happens. So we will give, you know, certain problems to individuals. Our own, you know, what we are looking at is not whether it's a right answer or wrong answer or whatever. It's about how the individual has really approached the learning, the solution. What is the problem? You know, what is the way? What is the methodology? And if this is all open book, they can call people, they can, you know, take help from everyone. But then we have a software running beneath the whole layer which actually tracks what is the effort that they have really put in. And why that is? That is basically you have to show them to say, are you really putting in the effort? And that's my sincere advice to you. Guys, please don't wait for the organization to be saying that, have you read this, have you read that, and stuff like that. Okay, or that initiative has to come from us. Are we reading sufficient? So today at Mindtree, you know, every company also has its own leadership model. And learning agility is one big thing. So learning agility, how do we define learning agility? So learning agility we define as four subsets. The first one is mental agility, right? Mental agility doesn't mean is our IQ or anything. It's about having a point of view. It's about diversity, diverse views. I should be in a position to learn about, to talk about politics. I should be in a position to talk about economics. I should be talking about marketing, about HR, about, you know, about sports, whatever it is. And that's what makes you an interesting person. Tomorrow when you are with customers, tomorrow when you are with someone, you know, you have to understand the needs of what the other person is, what are the interests of the other person. And you have to start a conversation. You know, if all of us don't understand, you know, what is happening globally, I'll tell you, none of us will be interesting. People will just say hi, hello, and get out from there. And that's what we need to, and that's how we define mental agility. You have to come out of your comfort zone, do that different things. And one simple thing which at least I took up in my individual development plan was to start reading about literature, start reading about mythology and things like that. You know, that really helps. About civilizations. And that's how you build your mental agility around the whole thing. The second one is about people. And, you know, as we grow in our careers, everything depends upon this one thing. You know, how are you working with people? Today, organizations, you know, have people leaving. They don't leave the organization. They actually leave managers. And to be a good manager, to be a good professional, it is important that the people agility actually comes into play. You have to respect the diversity. We have to respect, you know, what is the other person's point of view. And that is where the people agility comes in. If we don't respect other people's view, people are not going to like each other, right? So that's basically how it changes. The third thing is about change. The change agility. And, you know, in the introduction, people, you know, the professor spoke about VUCA world. And in a VUCA world, it's about how quickly are we able to adapt to that change. So today, if there is a problem going in any industry or anything, it's how quickly are we able to adapt to that change and get moving. It is there for companies, it is there for institutions, it is there for individuals. And for individuals, it becomes very, very, very important. Because one, if you cannot change, I'll tell you, we will actually get killed. Now, this is where Marshall Goldsmith's book comes into play. Right, he said, what got you here will not get you there. And that's a big, big statement. That actually talks about the change that all of us have to really initiate. We have to change our personalities at any point of time. Now, I'll also mention about change. I'll give an example of change, how Mindtree did a change, you know, because our brand logo, everything changed. But let me just pick up the fourth agility. And the fourth agility is about result agility. It's about results. Everything can be good. People agility can be good, your mental agility can be good, change agility can be good, but at the end of the day, if you don't deliver the results, okay, what our superiors actually, what the organization expects us to do, I'll tell you everything is waste. So at the end point of, finally it's about achieving those objectives, achieving those results, it's really, really important. And if we have those four agilities, what we are trying to do is, when we put people into new environments, okay, new challenges, they should be coming as winners in the very first iteration. That's really about, that's really what learning agility is. And today most organizations actually want people to be learning agile. They want people to be really high on all the four agilities. So that's what the learning agility part is there. Now, as I said, change agility. What is the change agility Mindtree actually brought in? Now we were, you know, today the logo that, you know, we have, you know, that actually changed in 2012. Why did we feel the need for that? The earlier work was a work by a spastic child. It was a, you know, a prominent red color logo with a stroke of brush on that, which actually defined imagination, action, and joy. Now, 99 to 2011, we realized that if we have to grow in a different way, we need to change ourselves. And we have to message to the world that we are changing. It is a messaging to our own internal stakeholders, our employees, that we need to grow, develop in a different way. And that's where the whole expertise game came into play. Right? So we actually, you know, got an external consultant based out of LA to really help us with the brand, new brand. We changed our values, value statements. The overall culture values did not change. But the value statements to bring in that expertise. Earlier it was known as a very soft organization. Our value statements were also very soft. It was class, caring, learning, achieving, sharing, and being socially responsible. After that, we moved into just three simple things around expertise, around collaboration, around unrelenting dedication. So that's all the change that we brought in. And, you know, we said 2013, we got in BIMM consultants to really help us in our strategy. We were 435 million and we said we took a target saying that 2x by 4y. So we will double our revenues in 4 years. Right? So that those are some of the audacious targets one has to take in the whole process. You cannot grow, you know, without having a solid strategy in place. With that, every functions will have to have a strategy in place. How are we going to look at it? So for me, it is about talent management. How am I going to retain people, retain the high performers, attract the high talent. You know, so those are some of few of the things that will come into play. And today our whole strategy is around, if we have to really create the organization for the future, what is the sort of reskilling that is required? What is the adjacent skills that are required for every individual so that we create those multi-skilled engineers? So that becomes a real focus for us. How do we create that full stack engineers? So in the interest of time, I will you know, just skip all those things. And that's basically what we say, we are creating the engineers of tomorrow. It's not just about engineering skills. It's also about giving them the business skills, the social skills. That really becomes the becoming the key thing. Now look at it here, you know, just to the right side, I'll just make this one statement. It's about multiple intelligence. And that is where I say, you know, we need to be, as professionals, we need to have those multiple intelligences. We need to look at how we are working on our mental agility. So on a closing note, I would actually like to, you know, quote Howard Gardner out here. Has anybody read the book, Five Minds of the Future? Yeah, so that's again a book which I would highly recommend for people to really look at it. And in that, Howard Gardner actually says that there are five types of minds. The first mind is a disciplined mind. Okay, and discipline comes from practice, discipline comes from reading, discipline comes from on the job, training, what is it that we do on a day-to-day work. And obviously there's so much of research which actually says that it takes 10,000 hours to be really an expert in some area. And 10,000 hours is not just, you know, 2 years out here or a couple of years in, you know, the next company or things like that. It takes very solid, you know, a goalpost out there how you want to develop that, you know, expertise in that 10,000 hours. Just look at any of the sports guys. Look at the amount of training that they would be doing. They would actually sacrifice everything, a PV Sindhu or anybody. And that's the real story behind the 10,000 hours, that I would say. The second thing is a synthesizing mind. And here I spoke about three things, volume, variety, and velocity. So there's so much of data. The mind of the future will have to synthesize this data in a big way and try to make it in an easily understandable thing. Today, Google is there, right, to give you data at any point of view, whatever data. But the future will belong to the guys who are able to synthesize that data and make it more meaningful. The third is creative mind, right? Creativity is becoming more and more important. Okay, and that is what will differentiate how are we different from the rest of the things. If you look at, just look around. Earlier, there were only two subjects, at least in my age, when I was actually studying. Our parents would say, it is only medical or non-medical, engineering or non-engineering. Today, there's so much of opportunities that are opened up in liberal arts. Right? Parents today are sending their kids for sports, for music, for, you know, a lot of things. Companies are investing a lot in innovation. Okay, coming out with ideas, what can do. So being a creative mind, you know, is going to be very, very essential point of view. You know, how are you going to actually work on that problem is going to be very, very important. The fourth one is around respectful mind. And when I say respectful mind, it's about valuing each other's thoughts, views, diversity of, you know, thoughts. And Balasar actually said, when you're actually listening to the speakers, today there will be 5-6 speakers who will come in. Everybody will have a different viewpoint, thought point. There's nothing wrong or right. It's their view, it's your view. You have to really look at it. So respecting that becomes very, very important. Respecting your own friends' views becomes very important. Respecting your teachers' views becomes very, very important. And that becomes a respectful. Because with respect, okay, you build trust. Right? That's the most important. And with trust, what happens? You build relationships. So that's where the whole thing around a respectful mind comes in. The last mind, the last state what he actually says, is about being ethical. It's an ethical mind. An ethical mind is doing the right things. Being, you know, simple things for us out here can be being on time. Okay, doing our assignments on time. That is, those are some of the basic values. Okay, which can never change. I'll tell you, down the years also, if we were to stand here and talk after 20 years, you know, what Professor Bala used to actually tell us, you know, I'll tell you, the same drill used to happen. Why are you not on time? Why are you, know, this, that, you know. I'll tell you, but at the end of the day, when I go back and reflect that, these are things that really help. Okay, if there is a dress code, there's nothing wrong about it. It's very good, because at the end of the day, when you are in an organization, the organization will not allow you to actually come dressed shabbily and things like that. I pull up people when they are not in shoes. Okay, so, you know, and that's some values which we have inculcated at some point of time. So that's basically about being an ethical mind, because ethical mind, again, you know, you develop relationships, you develop trust, and that is what really helps being for the future. So five minds, to summarize, the first one is what?
Discipline
mind. What's the second mind? Synthesizing. Third? Fourth? And fifth?
Ethical.
Yeah, so please read the book as well. This will all help you actually as you sit for placements, as you sit for, you know, in your future. And on that note, thank you very much for inviting me over and, you know, got this opportunity to share time with you. So I have 10 minutes over time. So if there are a couple of questions, I can do that, and I'll be here till lunchtime. So my flight is only in the evening, so I can if you have any questions, you can always reach out to me. Thank
you. The house is now open for question and answer session.
Sir, I'm from BIMM HRD Bank. Sir, recently or nowadays we hear in news that IT companies are sacking 2,000 employees or something like that. Is that a business strategy or an HR strategy where I recruit 4,000 employees, I keep 2,000 high potentials and I sack the rest 2,000 employees?
Yeah.
When I have already planned in my manpower planning that I only need 2,000, but I will recruit 4,000 to make sure that I have 2,000 best employees.
Sure, your name. But if you look at it, IT companies were always doing that for their bottom 5%. There's nothing wrong about it, right? The bottom people had to actually move out. Where the problem today is happening, because of the single digit growth, companies are and a lot of automation and all those things, the job growth rate is not that high. Right? Hence, people are all not actually seeing when they are going out, those many jobs being available. The biggest challenge is for the middle management. And that is where I said is about expertise. Are you an expert in something? So there is a layer of people who are actually only doing the people management part. I'll tell you, that job is just going to go away. If it is just management, allocation of tasks and all, one can automate. Okay, that job will get automated at some point of time. Today there's so much of automation going on. So if somebody is really not an expert in that, from a T-shaped or a pie-shaped to a comb-shaped individual, or becoming a multi-skilled engineer, right? Or has the adaptability to really switch into something. Context switching has to be really, really important. I think that's where the problem is going to come in. Right? So companies have always been doing clearing up the bottom performers, because otherwise organizations cannot grow. If you obviously are, there's a benchmark. Every organization has to at every point of time move, in a different way. But if you continue to hoard or keep the bottom performers, it is going to affect, in the long run, it's going to affect the company's growth as well. But the lot of noise is around because today those set of individuals are not finding jobs. So it is going to create a big socio-economic issue as well, because folks might have, taken homes, their kids are studying in the best of school, their EMIs, multiple things are there. And it's going to create a lot of problems. So it is important for every individual, right, to reskill themselves, to really look at what is it that they can do outside of their regular work. That becomes very, very important for individuals. Right? And today, if people are actually investing in, this is the first time IT engineers are actually investing a lot in themselves. Earlier, they were waiting for the company to invest in them. Today, they are spending 4 lakhs, 5 lakhs and things like that to really go get themselves certified on something, to really look at what, certified on a digital skill or an IoT or on automation and things like that. They're doing all those things. So that's the reason for it.
Sir, I have a few questions. My first question is, recently there was a share buyback of Mindtree close to 43.2 lakh rupees. Can you just tell us what was the objective behind it? And my second question is, currently when first year quarter one results were declared of financial year 18, the EBITDA margin has dropped from 19.9% to 11.1%.
Correct.
So right now when we see that IT industry is going through a tumultuous time, how do we plan? That is, how does Mindtree plan to go ahead?
Okay, wonderful. So, great question. I see that you've done a lot of research. So, excellent. So, let me take the second question first, and please be seated. Is around why has the EBITDA margin been going down? And that is also correlation to our stock price actually coming down significantly as well. I think couple of reasons behind that. The first thing is that is about certain investments that we are making, right? And when I say investments, we have acquired a couple of companies, one in UK and the second one in the US. These are high-end consulting companies, so the cost obviously goes high, and with that, your when you do that, your EBITDA will actually take a hit if those companies also don't perform in the same way. Right? So that's the first reason behind that. The second thing I've already mentioned out here, the growth rate in companies are actually coming down. Okay, from a double-digit growth that used to be there, it is coming to a teens or a single-digit growth rate. With that, what will happen is, we are not, what it really means is customers are also not spending that much. Customers are also struggling, or there is a pricing pressure which really happens. The third thing is the salary levels of people have, only been increasing. And if we are making our investments into digital, into Horizon 2 and 3 technologies, the salaries continue to be on the higher side. With that, what would happen is it would actually put, so the gross margin one, which IT companies measure, what is gross margin one? It's your revenues as well as the direct salary cost. So on one side, the pricing is actually not improving. Customers are not willing to pay anything more. Plus your salaries are actually on the high. Your gross margin one will actually tend to decrease. The second thing is gross margin is also coming down because of a lot of local hiring that we are doing in respective geographies, right? So we are creating a bench strength for ourselves out there, and that's because we have to train people. We have to be prepared not for now. We cannot be living for the moment. We have to live 2 years from now, right? So this all adds on to the whole issue on the margin part of it. I think currency also I mentioned. I think currency is also again playing a big game out here. What was 68 has moved to a 63 sort of thing. So currency fluctuations will obviously very clearly do that. And in the last couple of quarters, how the pound has moved and stuff like that. So pound dollar movement for us, because that's the two larger geographies for us that we operate, significantly affects the profitability. Hence, the EBITDA will go down. But that will actually not, we have actually, and to improve our investments, what we have done is we have actually moved most of our business-facing guys to the market. They are all now based out of the US. At one point of time, they were in India. They used to travel and all. But now they have moved more to US, Europe, and things like that. More of hiring senior people, sales people. Because we are not living for the moment right now. We're making investments for 2 years down the line. Right? And that's the reason for that. So it will again come back. Why are we doing a buyback? If you look at most of the other companies have also done that particular thing, I think it's more to do with improving our earnings per share. It has to do with giving a better return to the shareholders. So that's the reason why we are actually going in for that.
Thank you, sir. Sir, thank you for teaching us the importance of values and being an expert in the domain. As every fall has its rise, by your teachings we understand that we can rise again by patience and perseverance. Thank you so much, sir.